All right. I'm going to mess with this thing all day, I can tell it. But okay. We're in the middle of chapters 9 through 11. Lois asked me, she said, are you in chapter 12 today? No, we're not. We might get to 11. But we're in the middle of 9 through 11. Let me real quickly summarize what I see going on in chapter 9, and we'll pick back up in the beginning of chapter 10. In chapters 9 through 11, Paul is addressing this issue that's posed by Israel's large-scale rejection of the gospel. And in the first five verses of chapter 9, he expresses his great sorrow that so many of his fellow Jews are under condemnation. You remember how passionate Paul expresses that. Passionately he expresses that. In chapter 9, verses 6 through 13, he argues that the tension between God's promises to Israel and Israel's plight, that that's only apparent. That tension's not real because the promises were intended for true Israel, that subset of physical Israel that had the faith of Abraham. So we looked at that in verses 6 through 13. Verses 14 through 18 of chapter 9, he says the fact God blesses some undeserving Jews, the believers, while not blessing other undeserving Jews, the unbelievers, that doesn't make him unjust. As God, as he told Moses, the granting of mercy, it's not an issue of justice. You see, the granting of mercy is solely a matter of his gracious and goodwill. He says in chapter 9, verses 19 to 23, he makes the point that God's use of unbelieving Israel for his larger purpose doesn't make Israel blameless. It doesn't explain and excuse their sin, and it doesn't shift responsibility for their condemnation to God. And if we get to it, we'll see that it's really mind-blowing what God is doing with Israel in terms of the Gentile mission and that's effect on Israel itself. In 9:24 to 33, Paul points out that those predestined for eternal glory, the believers, that they were called by God through the gospel, not only from the Jews, but also from the Gentiles, as God had prefigured in the prophet Hosea, and as Isaiah foretold, only a remnant, a subset of physical Israel will be saved. Now, Gentiles, Paul says there, the Gentiles, they gained the righteousness that's received through faith, and they did that through their acceptance of Christ, whereas the Jews, for the most part, the Jews did not gain that righteousness because they pursued righteousness in terms of the works of the Mosaic law. In other words, they had come to see their obedience to the Mosaic law, especially those elements that distinguished them from Gentiles. They had come to see obedience to the Mosaic law as being the basis or the source of their righteousness before God. So they rejected the truth that Christ's bringing of the new covenant had rendered the Mosaic covenant and thus the laws that are embedded in that covenant, the commands, the do's and don'ts. So they had come to reject that truth that Christ's bringing of the new covenant, that had rendered the Mosaic covenant and therefore the laws attached to that covenant obsolete. They insisted on pulling the law of the old covenant into the new because they had come to misunderstand the function of the law. You know, they had warped the function of the law. Instead of being a teacher to lead them to Christ, it had become for them the grounds of their standing before God. That is what they took to be the basis of their relationship with God, is that I do these things. That's why I'm with God. And see, that's a false step. That's a false step. So whether they had rejected Christ outright, as many of them did, or sought to add Christ on to the necessity of living under the Mosaic law, either way, they denied that faith in Christ is the exclusive way of righteousness. You see, that the Judaizers, they'd say, okay, Christ is fine, but he has to be attached to the Mosaic law because the Mosaic law and doing those things is really the basis of our standing with God. So we can add him on, but he cannot be the exclusive basis of righteousness. And this was tied, see, to their having warped the function of the Mosaic law into a basis of their standing before God. Okay, I'd gone through all that before, but that's where we are. I want to pick back up in chapter 10, verses 1 to 4. Read it again. I won't say everything that I said about it before, but maybe repeat a little bit, then we'll go on. It says, "Brothers, as for me, the desire of my heart and the prayer to God for them is for salvation. For I testify about them that they have zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. For not knowing the righteousness of God and seeking to establish their own, they did not submit to the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of the law, that there may be righteousness for everyone who believes." Christ is the end of the law, that there may be righteousness for everyone who believes. Now, the Jews' pursuit of righteousness on their own, this righteousness based on law, is wrong, because with the coming of Christ, the authority of the Mosaic law is, in some basic sense, at an end. I mean, Christ is the goal of the law. He's that which the law anticipated and pointed toward. And as such, his coming brings the era of the Mosaic law to a close. That's what he says here. For Christ is the end of the law. See, he brings that era of the Mosaic law to a close. His inauguration of the new era, his inauguration, bringing of the new covenant, bringing of the kingdom of God, was the fulfillment or the culmination of the old covenant. You see, it didn't toss it away, it fulfilled it. And so that's what he says, it's the end. Now, after the coming of Christ, see, those who seek to relate to God under the Mosaic covenant, well, you're in a difficult spot. Because if you want to try to relate to God under the old covenant, you better not sin. You see, so you have to obey everything. When the covenant was effective, there was a means of accessing the grace of God that ultimately is based on the crucifixion of Christ. But with his coming in history now, those sacrifices are no longer effective, no longer recognized. So if you want to play under the old covenant, you better obey everything perfectly, or you have no mercy or sacrifices available. Now, as I said weeks ago, I think I've said more than once, and I know I've said it in more classes than this one, but it's because I think it's important, you see, that the law as the complete set of commands of the Mosaic covenant. And I never know if I'm getting through on this, but you have this covenant, and embedded in that covenant are do's and don'ts and commands that are part of that pact. And the law as the set of those commands, the set of commands under the Mosaic covenant, that's no longer in force. But the moral norms that were included in those commands, they have continuing validity. And indeed, they find their full expression in the new covenant. That some commands are included, that some of those included within the Mosaic covenant have ongoing validity, while others don't. It's clear from 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 19, where Paul says that circumcision is nothing, but keeping God's commandments is everything. And you go, circumcision is a commandment. And he would be saying, I don't mean those kinds of commandments. Those kinds of commandments, you see, that were peculiarly covenantal, those kinds of commandments I'm not talking about. The other commandments are everything. Okay, so that's an important thing. The fundamental ethical requirement for the Christian is love. I've said this, again, many times. But that is the fundamental, the bullseye, the heart of Christian ethics is love. And you see that in Matthew 7, 12, Matthew 22, 37 to 40, Romans 13, 8 and 10, Galatians 5, 14. That is the center, but some specific conduct is loving and other specific conduct is not. It's not that once we say, okay, love is the center, well, that it's anything goes. Oh, no. Love is that it has no meaning. It has no content. It's just say love and I can baptize any immorality by just saying it's love. No, there's objective content to love. And you can see that quite clearly in Romans chapter 13, verse 9, where he says the command to love your neighbor as yourself, it encompasses the commands of the law not to commit adultery, not to murder, not to steal and not to covet, and other commands he doesn't specify. You see, so there's real content to this Christian ethic of love. So the Christian, though not being under the Mosaic law, that set of commands, that body of commands that were part of the Mosaic covenant, upholds the transcendent moral requirements that were included in that set of commands. You see, we uphold the law, and it's this ongoing moral law that is centered in love that is the law of Christ. You see, so that's the, and it's just important. I just think there's a great deal of confusion about it. Now, by ending the era of the Mosaic law, during which time God was dealing mainly with Israel, Christ has made righteousness available for everyone who believes, both Jew and Gentile. In other words, since his coming, since Christ's coming, one can be saved as a Gentile. You can be saved as a Gentile. The people of God are no longer marked by submission to the Mosaic law. That's what the Judaizers kept arguing for. No. You can be all right with God, but you must come under the Mosaic law. It is sacrosanct. You cannot be saved without being under the Mosaic law and obeying it. You see? And so you say, well, no. You see, you can be saved as a Gentile. The people of God, with the coming of Christ, are no longer marked by submission to the Mosaic law. Okay, chapter 10, verses 5 through 13. For Moses writes about the righteousness that is from the law. The man who has done them will live by them. But the righteousness, shouldn't be a hyphen in there. I don't know why these hyphens keep popping up, but they do. There's nothing, I can't see them, so it's just kind of random, you know. All right. For Moses writes about the righteousness that is from the law. The man who has done them will live by them. But the righteousness from faith speaks thus. Do not say in your heart, who will go up into heaven, that is to bring Christ down, or who will go down into the abyss, that is to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we preach. Because if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes, resulting in righteousness, and with the mouth one confesses, resulting in salvation. For the scripture says, no one who believes on him will be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. For the same one is Lord of all, being rich toward all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Now, Paul elaborates on this righteousness that is by faith apart from law that he'd mentioned in Romans 3:21. This righteousness that is available to Jew and Greek, to Jew and Gentile alike. And the righteousness that is from the law, that right standing with God is bound up, that's bound up with the law and one's own works. He cites Leviticus 18, verse 5. You see, the righteousness that's from the law is the right standing with God that's bound up with the law and is tied up with one's works. So when he says, the man who has done them will live by them, it is the righteousness that Israel pursued but has not attained. As Paul said in chapter 9, 31 and 32, chapter 10, verse 3, it's the righteousness Israel pursued and didn't attain, and which Paul says in Philippians chapter 3, verse 9, that he discarded. It's the righteousness he discarded in favor of the righteousness of God. You see this idea? If you have a set of do's and commands, and you obey those commands, you will live by them. Okay, you will, but what's the truth? The truth is all are under sin. You see? So the righteousness that is based on performance and law, is based on law, is tied to this doing. You see, I did all these things. Okay, well, you're righteous. But who's righteous? Nobody on that basis, because all are under sin. Okay, so it's a significant thing. It's that Israel, that was what they got tied up into when they warped the law into being the basis of their standing before God and sought to depend on their performance and their obedience to the Mosaic law, that's what they relied on. That was their source of standing before God, is that I do these things and you don't. Okay, well, see, if you're going to do that, then you have to do them all. And of course, they do not, you see. Since law-based righteousness is works-based righteousness, right? Because you have to do all the things. And since that's the case, it's illusory. Because nobody renders perfect obedience. So Paul says here, for Moses writes about the righteous that is from the law, the man who has done them will live by them. Okay, well, that's right. The man who does them will live by them. But who does them? Nobody. Because all are under sin, as he said. Now, in contrast, the righteousness based on faith warns people. This is very interesting. Paul personifies the righteousness based on faith and has it speak through Scripture. You see, because of its close connection with God, he personifies it and has it speak through Scripture. The righteousness based on faith, it warns people not to claim that the saving word about Christ is beyond their reach, not to claim that it's dependent on something beyond their capabilities. That's what all this talk is about, going up and, you know, going down. Receiving that word doesn't require one to ascend into heaven. You see, to bring Christ down, because Christ already descended to earth in the incarnation, nor does it require one to descend into the abyss and bring Christ up from the dead, because Christ has already risen from the dead. You see, so it doesn't require that. It isn't dependent on something they cannot do, something beyond their capabilities. Just as God graciously made known to Israel the way of life under the old covenant, and Paul is referring here to Deuteronomy chapter 30, verses 11 to 14, and you can see that's this idea that God has made known to Israel the way of life. Well, just as he made known to Israel the way of life under the old covenant, so he's made known to Jew and Gentile alike the way of life under the new covenant, which is faith in Christ. He's made that known clearly. In contrast to what righteousness based on faith warns people not to say, the righteousness based on faith that is personified, and it warns people not to say those things, not to say that it's something beyond their capabilities. Well, in contrast to that, it positively asserts that the message about the righteousness of faith, the message that's preached by Paul and the other apostles, that it is accessible and it is understandable, as is evident by the presence of that word in the mouths and hearts of God's people. You see, here we have people, there it is, it's sitting right there. So it is clearly accessible and it is understandable because it's in the mouths and hearts of the people of God who are among you. So this is the thing. See, he says, look, in contrast to that, he says, the righteousness of faith warns people not to say this, then it asserts that the message preached by Paul, it is accessible, and that message is understandable. And then he says, look, that message that he's talking about, the gospel, is in the hearts and mouths of saints because righteousness / salvation is received through believing in the heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, which, of course, testifies to the efficacy of his death, the effectiveness of his death, that he was raised from the dead. So it requires one to believe in his heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, and confessing with the mouth that Jesus is Lord. That truth, that Jesus was raised from the dead and he's Lord. Now, Paul mentions only belief and confession. He mentions only those aspects of conversion because he's paralleling. You see, he's paralleling the use of mouth and heart in the quote from Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 14. He doesn't mean to exclude repentance. He doesn't mean to exclude baptism. I mean, conversion is a unit. Conversion is a package, and sometimes one or more aspects of that package are mentioned without others. I mean, Paul has already made clear, has he not, the significance of baptism to conversion in Romans chapter 6, verses 1 through 11. Indeed, the Baptist scholar, G.R. Beasley Murray, a very well-known Baptist scholar, he died some years ago, he writes in the Dictionary of Paul and his letters, he says, it is universally acknowledged. Now, even if you want to quarrel with that, for somebody of this guy's altitude in the academic world, for him to claim it's universally acknowledged, well, you know, it's a pretty big deal. I mean, it's awful lot of people agree with this. He says it's universally acknowledged that Jesus is Lord is the primitive confession of faith in Christ that was made at baptism. You see, so it's just the other side. I mean, that's part of baptism. Is what happens at baptism? One confesses Jesus is Lord. And so Paul, he uses here this idea. You see, he speaks of the heart and the mouth. He speaks of believe in the heart, confess, because he's tracking Deuteronomy 30:14, and not because he's saying, okay, this is all here. No need for baptism. Don't worry about that. See, that's not how you read things. That's not how to read the letter. Now, if Paul stopped and says, let me detour here and tell you all that's necessary for salvation, well, then it'd be a different story. But you have to understand what he's doing and how he's doing it, all right? So, now, as Scripture indicates, this salvation, it's available to all who believe. You see, all who call on God, Jew and Gentile. This salvation has been made available to all who call on his name, whether Jew or Gentile. So you and I call on God, we call on Christ, we accept the gospel message, and we are baptized into Christ, calling on his name in penitent faith. Jew or Gentile, it's open. All people, okay? You know, red, yellow, black, and white, they are precious in his sight. All people, come home. You see, come home, and that's just grand. All right, 10, 14 to 21. How then can they call on one in whom they did not believe? And how can they believe on one whom they did not hear? And how can they hear without one preaching? And how can they preach unless they are sent? Just as it is written, how welcome are the feet of those proclaiming good news, gospel of good things, but not all obeyed the gospel. Indeed, for Isaiah says, Lord, who believed our message? So then faith comes from hearing, and hearing comes through the word of Christ. But I say, did they not hear? On the contrary, their voice went out into all the earth, and their words to the ends of the world. But I say, did not Israel know? First, Moses says, I will provoke you to jealousy by a non-nation, by a senseless nation, I will make you angry. And Isaiah is bold and says, I was found by those who did not seek me. I became visible to those who did not ask for me. But concerning Israel, he says, all the day long I stretched out my hands to a disobedient and obstinate people. Now, Paul says here in 14 to 21, see, picking up on the fact that salvation is available to all who call on the Lord, Paul says that people cannot call on him if they do not believe in him. They cannot call on him if they do not believe in him. They cannot believe in him if they do not hear the word that proclaims Christ. So they can't call on him if they don't believe in him. They can't believe if they do not hear the word that proclaims Christ. And that word will not be heard unless someone preaches it. And since a preacher is nothing more than a herald, a preacher is a herald, one who's entrusted by another with a message. I'm announcing something, announcing good news. That's what a herald is. Someone who comes and says, hey, listen, I got something to say. I got some news. You need to hear this. Okay, well, that person is somebody who's been entrusted with that message. And see, preaching cannot happen, therefore, unless someone sends the preacher. You see, he's a herald. He's proclaiming a message with which he's been entrusted, and so someone must send the preacher. And the importance of preaching is confirmed in this passage in Isaiah where he says, how beautiful are the feet of those proclaiming good news of good things. And that passage, see, it also implies through this motion of proclaiming good news. You've heard that phrase before. You see, it implies through that phrase, proclaiming good news, that those preaching the gospel, the good news, that they are the messengers of God, and they've already been sent out. See, we're 25, 27 years down the road. They have been sent out to proclaim the news of what has happened in Jesus Christ. That He's come into this world and He's accomplished this amazing thing. He's inaugurated the kingdom. He's paid the price for all sin. And we're declaring that all over. Declaring that. So He says, yes, you know, they've already been sent out. And then in verse 16, make sure I got the right one. Okay. In verse 16, Paul focuses on the Jews. You see, as is clear from the reference to Israel in verse 19. And when he says in 16... that not all, okay, well, that's an understatement, see? When he says not all, yeah, indeed not all. It means that only a few. You see in 16 where he says here, but not all obeyed the gospel. Right, not all obeyed the gospel. A large segment did not obey the gospel. A large segment of the Jewish people. The fact of the matter, as confirmed by Isaiah, is that only a small number of Jews put their faith in Christ. Right? The church is Jewish at its root, but ultimately it was a small number of Jews who put their faith in Jesus Christ. They wound up turning against and rejecting it wholesale. That's the whole issue he's addressing in 9 through 11. This problem and this issue raised by Israel's wholesale or large rejection of the gospel. And then see, so he deals with it and mentions that, and then having injected there in verses, the second part of verse 15 and in verse 16, this premature word about Israel's failure, in verse 17, so then faith comes from hearing, he connects back up with the first part of verse 15. See, faith comes from a certain kind of hearing, and that kind of hearing comes only through the word of Christ. Only through the gospel message. You must hear this message. You must be exposed to this truth. You must be exposed to who is Jesus Christ, what did He do, and what does He call me to do? You see, you must be exposed to that to have this faith. Now, this Jewish hearing of the gospel, see, the Jews did, in fact, they heard the gospel. The Jews, he says, but I say, did they not hear? Did the Jews not hear? And in fact, they did hear. They heard the gospel, just like God's revelation in nature. Paul says that the voices and the words of Christian preachers have spread over the world. That they have spread over the world. Now, Paul says that hyperbolically. You see, he says that hyperbolically to mean that the gospel had been preached so widely that Jews everywhere, not every Jew, but that Jews everywhere had heard about it. He was the buzz. He was the deal. You see, so when he says, but did they not hear? On the contrary, the voice went out into all the world and there went words to the ends. Yes, they have heard the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. The gospel of Christ has gone out. You see, they've heard that message. And this Jewish hearing of the gospel was not the hearing of the message. It wasn't something that they couldn't understand. He says, but I say, did not Israel know? He says, didn't they hear? No, they heard. Did they not know? Was this gospel message something that they could not understand? No, they could understand it. As Moses and Isaiah indicated, the gospel was grasped by a non-nation. The gospel was grasped by a senseless nation, by those who were not seeking or asking for God. It was grasped by them. The Jews, therefore, cannot justifiably plead lack of comprehension. Their lack of comprehension, it was willful. It was culpable. You see, God appealed to them, but what were they? Stubborn and obstinate. All day long, I stretched out my hands to a disobedient and obstinate people. Cranfield, in his commentary on Romans, he says, the excuse of ignorance cannot be sustained. But it is to be noted that Paul is not withdrawing what he said in verses 2 and 3. You know, zeal without knowledge? Remember, he says they pursued it, but not without knowledge? He's not withdrawing that. He says the truth is that in one sense they know, and in another sense they do not know. They have been the recipients of God's special self-revelation, and yet they have been prehending. The ignorance, which is blameworthy, has been characteristic of them, but the ignorance which would have constituted an excuse, they cannot claim. I think that's how to understand that. You see, that's how to understand it, because here they are saying, listen, they're making this argument, you know, that Paul says, did they not hear? Yes, they heard. Didn't they understand? Didn't they get it? Yes, they got it. Or they could have gotten it if they hadn't suppressed it. Because senseless non-nations who weren't even seeking God got it. So how can you turn around and say, No. You can't say that. Then he says in chapter 11, verses 1 to 10, I ask therefore, did God reject his people? Absolutely not. For I too am an Israelite, from seed of Abraham, of the tribe of Benjamin. God did not reject his people whom he foreknew. Or do you not know what the scripture says in the section about Elijah? How he appeals to God against Israel. Lord, they killed your prophets. They tore down your altars. I alone was left and they're seeking my life. But what did the divine utterance say to him? I reserved for myself 7,000 men who did not bow a knee to Baal. Therefore, so also in the present time, a remnant has come into being according to a selection of grace. But if by grace it is no longer from works, for otherwise grace is no longer grace. What then? What Israel seeks after, this it did not obtain, but those selected obtained it. The rest were hardened. Just as it is written, God gave them a spirit of bewilderment, eyes that do not see and ears that do not hear until this very day. And David says, let their table become a snare and a trap, a stumbling block and a retribution to them. Let their eyes be darkened so that they do not see and bend their backs continually. All right. So you see this. In reporting Israel's rejection, back to the first. In reporting Israel's rejection of the gospel, Paul is not suggesting that God went back on his promises to bless Israel. He's just talked about that. Didn't they hear? Didn't they understand? No, they heard. I'm holding out my hands to an obstinate people. So in reporting Israel's rejection, he's not suggesting that God went back on his promise to bless Israel. The rejection of Israel is not total. Some Jews, Paul being exhibit A, the apostles, the early church, who do you think they were? They're Jews. See, they are Jews. That's the root of the church. So here we have, you know, so he says, look, that he didn't reject all Israel. Some Jews, Paul being a prime example, are among those receiving God's promised blessings in Jesus Christ. God didn't reject his people, those he foreknew as faithful. Because as Paul said in chapter 9, verses 6 and 7, and I pointed out the significance of that reasoning for when we got here, Paul pointed out there that Israel is not defined by mere physical descent. He wasn't unfaithful. Because Israel is not defined by mere physical descent. True Israel, the Israel of promise, is the remnant chosen by grace from among ethnic Israel on the condition of faith, not works of the law. You see that? So it's the faithful, the children of Abraham, who are chosen by grace on the condition of faith, not works of the law. Now, Israel as a whole, Israel of the flesh, they did not obtain the righteous status that they sought. They didn't obtain that status, but those who submitted to the righteousness of faith in Christ, they did obtain it. So here were these guys churning and wanting and trying to get this and after it, and thinking that the basis of it was, if I do the Mosaic law and I stick to that and that's the thing, they didn't get it because they refused to submit to the righteousness of God, which is through faith in Jesus Christ, period. So they didn't get it. But others did get it, you see. Others got it. The rest, he says, so Israel as a whole didn't obtain the righteous status that it sought, but those who submitted to the righteousness of faith in Christ, they did obtain it, and the rest, the unbelieving, he says, they were strengthened in their unbelief, sealed in their rejection of God's invitation, so as to serve the divine purpose that he's going to explain in the next section. Now this gets wild. And that's why I say at the end, when Paul just breaks out into this doxology, it is because you want to try to track God? You want to try to see what he's doing in the world? Well, wait till Paul takes you through this and you just go, oh man. You know, all right, just fall down. Just fall down. All right, see if I can get to this. We'll see. Probably not. All right. He says, I ask therefore, did they stumble so that they might fall? Absolutely not. But by their trespass, salvation comes to the Gentiles in order to provoke them to jealousy. And if their trespass means riches for the world, and their failure means riches for the Gentiles, even more their fulfilling will mean. I'll talk about that word in a second. I'm speaking to you Gentiles. So then, inasmuch as I am an apostle of the Gentiles, I glorify my ministry. Why, Paul? If somehow I may provoke my kindred, Jews, to jealousy and save some of them. For if the rejection of them means the reconciliation of the world, what will the acceptance of them mean except life from the dead? For if the first fruits are holy, so is the lump, and if the root is holy, so are the branches. Now, the purpose of God's hardening of unbelieving Israel was not to fix their fate by freezing them in their unbelief. God has not written them off. 5 minutes. Okay, he hasn't written them off. On the contrary, see, the hardening was intended ultimately what? It was intended ultimately to convert those Jews by promoting Gentile salvation and thereby provoking the Jews to faith through jealousy. So here we have the believers who come in. Those who don't believe are hardened. Why are they hardened? So then that will be the impetus for the gospel to go out to all of the world. We'll have the conversion of all these Gentiles. And what's the effect of that going to be? Because the Jews are then going to be jealous of the Gentiles cashing in on the riches of God's glory, and some of them will come to faith through that. See, it's God's evangelism strategy among the unbelieving Jews. It's his evangelism strategy among the unbelieving Jews, his way of adding to or maximizing the remnant. It's his way of adding to the remnant. After all, if their trespass, their failure, their rejection, if that meant riches, if that meant reconciliation for the world, for the Gentiles all over, well, then their fulfillment, their acceptance, will mean something even more. It'll mean something beyond that. It will mean their salvation. It will mean their receiving life from the dead. So unbelieving Jews, therefore, they can't be ignored. We cannot ignore unbelieving Jews. The church can't do that. But see, so here's this idea. You see this strategy that's at work. So what's God doing? He's using them for his purpose. They reject. He firms them in that. Mission goes out. Gentiles come in. Oh, what effect does that have? They start coming. Why? Out of jealousy. You see, it's part of this strategy. Now, Paul uses a word here in verse 12. He uses a word here that's most often translated fullness. You see, fullness, and his use of it here, I translate it fulfilling. But it's important because it sheds light on the meaning of that very same word in verse 25. Now, most people, a large number of folks, they take it to mean the full number, and it certainly can mean that. They take it to mean the full number, and thus they take it to be a reference to the full number of Jews who are going to convert to Christ, but that doesn't seem to me to fit the context very well. That doesn't seem to me to fit that. The contrast that Paul is making here is between Jewish trespass, Jewish failure, and Jewish rejection of the gospel, which brings blessings to the non-Gentile world. So he's contrasting on the one hand, Jewish trespass, Jewish failure, Jewish rejection of the gospel, and okay, which is to bring blessings to the Gentile world, and the fullness or fulfilling and acceptance of the gospel, which adds the blessing of an enlarged Jewish remnant. You see, so since that word, the word's pleroma, but since that word is contrasted to trespass, and it's contrasted to failure, and it's associated with acceptance, it seems to me the meaning fulfilling is best instead of full number. You see, in other words, if the Jews trespass against the command to believe in Jesus, their trespass against that command to believe in Jesus by rejecting the gospel, if that means blessings for the Gentiles, if that means blessings for the Gentiles, then their fulfilling of the command by accepting the gospel will mean additional blessings. That is, it will mean the enlargement of the Jewish remnant on top of the Gentiles who have come to faith. See, so I think fulfilling, now lest you think I'm playing fast and easy, fulfilling is one of the definitions given to that word in the standard Greek lexicon. In fact, they cite it in this very verse. And it also has that meaning and that nuance to it in chapter 13, verse 10. So it's not odd for me to be doing that. I just think that is the proper meaning that fits here, and it fits better. See, if they become, and then this last part down here, see, if these Jews, if they become by faith, and we'll see next, you know, where he's going to talk about grafting back in. If these Jews become by faith part of the lump, I heard that one this time, but I'm going to say just a little bit more, okay? Really short. All right, if they become by faith part of the lump from which the holy first fruits, he's probably talking about the patriarchs there, but if they become by faith part of the lump from which the holy first fruits were taken, then they also are holy. And if they become by faith a branch of a tree with holy roots, then they also are holy. See, so this is the idea, as you'll see. When we get to the next chapter, he talks about, well, they can be cut off by, if they don't believe, grafted back in. Who are the Gentiles? We have true Israel as a root, and who gets grafted in to make new Israel? These Gentiles, they get grafted into that root. If they don't keep believing, off. In, off. Why? Faith. Believe in, don't believe out. Okay? I heard that bell. Thanks.